Hello everyone and welcome back to The Layout. Today we're taking a look at a Atlas GP38 from the most recent run here. I believe these came out in January and well, as you guys know with me, I get a little bit behind, so just getting around to checking this one out. Now technically this is a Norfolk Southern unit, it's not a Conrail unit. It's painted Conrail, but it's numbered 2943, which was after the Conrail split. But either way, these new Atlas units have a working ditch lights up here, which is a first for Atlas, so I really wanted to check one of these out. And the 25 years of safety and service on here I really thought was neat, so I went ahead and picked one of these up and figured I'd go ahead and kind of document it a little bit, show it off for if anybody in the future wants to check one of these out and wants to know what the skinny is on them, what's different, what's cool, all that fun jazz. So go ahead and sit back, relax, and dive in as we check out the newest run of Atlas GP38s. All right, so let's go ahead and start this off with an unboxing here. This is the packaging that these units come in from Atlas here. Pretty nice little box deal. I like how these got like the sleeve and the inner box to them here. So you got your inner box that holds your model. And we got your, what we got down in here. We got warranty registration card. Oh, the parts diagram, always enjoy those. What's this here? More warranty info, and then our function list, etc., for our ESU decoder. We'll be using that here in a few minutes. We'll keep that handy. But typical Atlas packaging here with this like outer piece here and these two side deals that essentially go together. Now this is probably actually my favorite packaging from any manufacturer when it's all said and done. I really like how Atlas does these. Having these screws in the bottom may not be the most prototypical deal when it's all said and done if you look at the bottom of the locomotive, but I really, really like these for how they are for storing a locomotive when it's not on the layout. I really like this design. Just because you get into what some of the other manufacturers do with their, like they have those plastic clamshell deals, and there's always like that piece of thin plastic you got to try and put on top of a locomotive. It's always a pain in the rear end to get that to work right. So go ahead and set that down. Looks like we've got some plugs for our holes in the bottom where the screws going out, as well as some sunshades as well in our box here. But here's our locomotive first. I'll go ahead and reset this up here so we could take a closer look at it. All right, so we got our locomotive out here on our little turntable deal so we can kind of take a closer look at it here. Now this is from the master line, so it should have all the fancy pants details that Atlas does here. So you got like your separate grab irons, your little lift ring deals. You've got our little antenna up there. Also have some MU hoses, coupler cut lever, air hose, a little step deal there that I believe flip. Oh yeah, it flips down. That's how you want it right there. But overall, the detailing looks really crisp on these. The paint looks excellent. really, really sharp paint. All these little details, all these little warning labels and such. Here, let me zoom in. These look really, really good. Really, really nice detail on these warning labels. And it's the emergency fuel cutoff there. That looks pretty sharp. Also, have our little lift rings up here on the top. Standard truck detail here, etc. Now, this locomotive isn't detailed 100% prototypical. These are kind of more or less a little bit of the same on every Atlas unit. Like, this doesn't have a cab signal box. I'm not sure if the real unit had it or not. I believe it did, though. And our plow looks a little bit wonky because it's just Atlas's wonky plow they use on all of these. But overall, for what you're getting, it really don't look too shabby. It looks pretty dang good. Now, it looks like right here, I'm missing the tip from my air hose there. That kind of stinks, but not the end of the world, because I'll end up putting one of my magnetic ones on it anyway. These ditch lights look pretty good. It's kind of hard to really see in there. I can't tell if there's an LED in there or not. We'll find that out a little bit later. That was the whole reason I picked this unit up, is because I wanted to see how the ditch lights were on these. This is the first time Atlas has done ditch lights on a GP38, so I was very, very curious of that. And definitely stay tuned later for any of you that are curious as well, because I will take the shell off this and we're going to find out what things look like. But over here on our engineer side, see, we got our little engineer in there. One of my favorite parts about the Atlas units is they have that. But overall, looks pretty freaking good. I'm really, really impressed with how this looks. Now, it does look like I'm missing a little lift ring eyelet deal there. Oh, yeah, we're missing it, because there's the one on that side. It's a bit disappointing. A little bit disappointing. And then we have one up here on the top as well. If the camera's probably going to have a hard time picking that up, but that's bent over a little bit. So that kind of stinks a little bit. Little QC problems from the old Atlas here. But a plus side, for the first time, Atlas actually has the correct style fans on these, which is pretty freaking cool. I like seeing that. It looks pretty good, but overall, I'm pretty pleased with this. You know, you could always wish for more on these and wish that Atlas did this or that to make them look better or make them more correct for your railroad. But at the same time, they're also 2/3 of the price of what some of these other manufacturers charge for a locomotive that's perfect, you know, and all that. So I'll kind of save, I'll take a little bit of monetary savings and have to do like a little bit of upgrade work over spending a bunch more money for, you know, some minor things I could do myself. So let's go ahead and let's move on to some of our standards and taking a look at things here. All right, so the first thing we're going to take a look at here with our standards and such here is we're going to go ahead and we're going to weigh this sucker and see how heavy she is, because, you know, why not? Let's find out what we got here for weight. These Atlas units are pretty heavy. This is 13.45 ounces. Not sure if you're going to see that in the camera or not. But 13.45, which is pretty good. These generally have quite a bit of weight in them, so they generally pull a lot of cars. Really, really nice that they are like that. All right, now we're going to go ahead and we're going to check out our coupler height here and see exactly what we're looking at here, this KD height gauge here. Now, these do have the Atlas plastic couplers, which I'm not really a big fan of, but it looks like we're right on the money there. I like that. I like seeing that. Go ahead and move down here to our rear end and check this out here. And that looks like that's good to go too. So good coupler height. Looks like this is handrails bent in a little bit too. Oh boy, always something. Always something. Now let's go ahead and let's check out the sound features on this unit. All right, first things first here. Let's check out our headlight here, pressing F0. See what we can get on this here. And of course, with Atlas, the number boards and the headlights are tied together and are directional. So, in forward, you have the front one. In reverse, the rear one's coming on right now, like it should. And F6, according to this, turns on the ditch lights. Okay, got a little ditch light action there. In forward, and they do come on in reverse. Actually, don't look too shabby. They're a little bit yellow, a little bit like golden yellow. A little bit more so than the number boards and headlights. Pretty much exactly like what it looks like in the camera. They're a little bit on the golden yellow side, but overall, they don't look too bad. Now, supposedly these flash. Oh yeah, right out of the box, she's flashing. Now let's go ahead and let's fire this unit up with F8 here. This has got the ESU Loxound V5 in it, so sounding pretty good. There's our bell on F1. Our horn on F2 with the flashing ditch lights there. F3's got that coupler action going on there. But that's going to be the main functions here we're going to look at. Let's go ahead and let's see how she moves here. Let's give her a little go here. That's speed step one right there. Just right out of the box. No tuning, no braking, no nothing. Pretty smooth, like you'd expect the Atlas unit to be. Go ahead and crank her up a little bit. Overall, looking pretty good. I'm liking what I'm seeing here. Alright, so we're over here at the workbench now. We're going to get into one of my favorite parts of these videos, and that's where I try to take the shell off this and see what the inside looks like, because I know I'm probably not the only one that's interested in this, being somebody that does a lot of redos, and I like to add lighting and all that stuff, so I kind of get curious what the inside of these units looks like, especially when it's a new run, to see if they changed anything, and all that fun stuff. And then, you know, for any of you out there that maybe need to get into yours to do some maintenance work, it never hurts to see somebody else take one of these apart and see if they're what the hidden trick is, because some of these can be tricky, especially these Atlas units. They always kind of have this way of the shell not wanting to come off. But we're gonna go ahead and we're pulling our coupler boxes out. It's kind of your first course of action here. And, you know, try not to drop everything in there. That normally helps, too. Doesn't help that these couplers are this stupid two-piece plastic job. I don't understand this nonsense here. That's going right in the trash. All right, so we got our screws out. Now, normally with these, you got to kind of, like, pinch a little bit down at the bottom of the frame to get the taps to break loose. Wow, this one came off real easy. All right, so what do we got in here? Let's take a look here. See if I can get my camera to focus. Looks like all of our ditch lights do actually have LEDs in them, which is, that's very nice to see. Still using the dopey single light bulb for the number boards and headlights, but looks like these ditch lights have like a connector here. See if I can get that a little closer to the camera there. It won't focus, of course, but there's a connector so you can remove your shell. That's pretty nice. I like seeing that. And of course, our standard 21-pin ESU V5 decoder. Now, from what I can tell here, it doesn't look like you'd be able to fit the keep alive in here. You might be able to, but myself personally, if I was going to add one, I'd probably end up swapping out the speaker anyway. See if we can, it's just a normal, see if I get that camera. I'll have to zoom that in when I'm editing, but that's just a normal cheesy speaker. it's not a Sugar Cube or any of the good sounding stuff, so that's always interesting to see. And then, of course, when you go to put your shell back on, you just got to kind of press it on, and kind of impressed at how easy this one came on and off. Normally, these Atlas shells will kind of fight you a lot more, but good to see that this one came apart real nice. So let me get these coupler boxes in. I got one more little thing to show here. All right, so we have our shell back on. I went ahead and threw some KD couplers on this while I was at it here. Now, one of the big drawbacks of these Atlas unit that kind of drives me crazy is like these MU hoses and all that are just black plastic. They don't have any like silver detail on the end of them. So what we're going to go ahead and do here is I have this Sharpie oil-based pen here. Okay, it's like a silver chrome deal. Now, for warning for all you guys, these can get a little bit messy, but what I'm going to do is I'm just going to very carefully go around the edges of this ditch light, just like what the real units have. We're going to go ahead and we're going to do the edges of the ditch light, and then we're going to go down and we're going to do all the air hoses as well. Hopefully, I won't screw this up too bad trying to do this around the camera here, but more or less, I just wanted to show this just kind of, it's a real easy little upgrade you can do that'll really make these units look better. You know, just something very, very simple that anybody really can do here. This isn't any rocket science. It's just taking your time and, you know, doing just a little bit more, and just really changes these to look a lot more realistic. So, you know, it's kind of hard to get these ones right up here. Little fittings up there will get a little bit too much, but that's fine. Now, obviously, when I eventually build this unit, I'll be swapping out the plow for a better one. I'll more than likely change the ditch lights as well. But just for the pure sake of showing some minor upgrades you can do here, I just wanted to include this in here. Now, the next little thing I'm going to do is another little Conrail thing they did was, you'll notice the grab irons on these are painted all blue. Well, Conrail always used to paint on a lot of these units, like the center section white. They used to do that quite frequently. So we got a little white acrylic paint here on our micro brush. We're just going to put a little white paint on there. Again, we're not trying to get too fancy here. We're just, you know, little basic upgrades. Just to kind of bring it to life a little bit more and make our details look a little bit better. Another thing you can also do, which I'm not going to do, but you can take that silver paint and essentially paint your class lights as well, which in Conrail world are marker lights, but I'm not doing that because this will eventually get lit class lights, so I'm not even going to bother messing with that on this particular model. But technically, this little MU receptacle stand should be painted blue and not black, but I don't feel like trying to pop that off and paint it blue. I'm just going to put a little red paint on it here, on at least on the little hatch cover that's on there. Just again, add a little spice to it, add a little variety. And last but not least, with our acrylic paint, I'm going to come over here to this coupler cut bar and just get the tip of it white there. And basically what we're doing here is just, you know, this is all 3 minutes right here is what the camera's showing. But just really, really adds another level of little detail to it that isn't all that hard to do, but, you know, really brings things to life a little bit more. But that's going to do it for our look into these Atlas GP38s, guys. I really appreciate everybody that's watched and that's stayed along for this ride here. Overall, I mean, even with the minor little things I found that were wrong with mine, I'm still very, very happy with it. And I really look forward to when Atlas does more of these units with ditch lights. I'm hoping they do ones with the modified dynamic brake blister again, because I could really use a bunch of those. But overall, really cool model. You know, even though this is technically an NS model, as you guys can tell, a little Pennsylvania Railroad right there, I plan on eventually taking this, and I want to modify it to say 20 years of safety and service. So I'm about to find a zero that matches that font. And then I'm going to renumber it to its original Conrail number, which was 7899. And it's going to kind of be like my safety unit, I guess, for the ONWV. It'll be kind of like an Operation Lifesaver kind of deal. Maybe find one of those small decals I could put somewhere on it just to kind of, you know, make it kind of like a special unit for the ONWV only. But anyway, guys, I want to thank everybody that's watching. And until next time, y'all have a good one.
We'll be right back.